Hi, I'm Donovan with another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with Galruf, and we're going to learn about Data Factory V2. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, Donovan.
So why is V2? What makes V2 special?
So essentially, we have been a GA service for 2 years now.
Okay.
We released Azure Data Factory V1 back in October 2015 as a GA service. And what we learned over a period of time is that there's a bunch of data integration patterns that we don't support in ADF V1. So what we have done is that we have released a brand new version of Data Factory with great flexibility in the app model to support additional control flow features like iteration, loops, branching, parameter passing. So every pipeline is a parameterized endpoint now.
Oh, okay.
So you can essentially call it from Data Factory constructs like triggers, or you can call it from other Azure services like Azure Functions. So it gives our customers flexibility to mimic those data integration patterns that were not earlier supported in Data Factory V1.
All right, so this sounds to me, I'm an old school guy, sounds like BizTalk to me. Is this BizTalk in the cloud, or is this something different?
So this is something different because BizTalk is targeted towards enterprise application integration.
Okay.
So think of Coke integrating with Walmart, and this is more of data integration scenarios. So Data Factory is a managed data integration service in cloud that allows you to build your ETL or ELT pipelines end-to-end in Azure.
All right, so this is taking data from one, polishing it and putting it into another data source for me to be able to use.
Absolutely. So we actually have support for 65 data sources
now
that allow, when we allow you to ingest data from those sources into Azure.
Okay.
And there are certain sources that we support for egressing data as well.
Perfect. So show me how it works.
So you're going to click plus, and Data Factory is there in data and analytics. So you go here, you click Data Factory, and you'll be presented with a blade where you can provide the name of the Data Factory, select an Azure subscription, and provide other details. So once you create your Data Factory, and if you pin it to your dashboard, you would have something like this. And from here, what we have done is that we have enabled author and monitor tile, which you can click, and all it is going to do is that it is going to launch this brand new UX that we have built ground up.
Okay.
Yeah. And with this UX, what we are doing is that we are exposing certain quick actions that if you wanted to get started with Data Factory V2 and you wanted to come and build your first pipeline, then you can do that. You wanted to copy data from a bunch of sources, you can launch that. If you're an SSIS user, with ADF V2, we announced a capability where you can lift and shift your SSIS packages to Azure. So you can actually configure your SSIS integration runtime over here. So if you were to click this, it will show you exactly how you can do that.
Okay.
So you can just provision VMs in Azure, and we would essentially run your packages on these VMs. And we'll take that infrastructure portion away from you.
Okay, great.
So going back, you have quick overviews about Data Factory, videos, feature tutorials. So if you wanted to use the app to copy data, to transform data, how you can do that, these are all feature tutorials that show you step by step how you can use this new visual experience to do that.
Okay.
So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to quickly go click create pipeline, and essentially this is going to take us to our author tab, which we call, and it is presenting us with a blank pipeline canvas, and now I'm ready to create my activities in the pipeline.
Okay.
So for this demo, I'm just going to copy data from Amazon S3 to Blob.
Okay.
So I'm just going to search for a copy activity and drag and drop a copy activity on the canvas.
Okay.
We are going to name this as S3 to Blob copy. And we are essentially going to provide the source. So in this case, the source is going to be Amazon S3. So I'm going to select Amazon S3 from this a bunch of sources that we support. Like I mentioned, we have support for 65 data sources right
okay.
now. So I select Amazon S3. And at this point, I'm just going to provide the Amazon S3 connection. So I've already created that. With this UX, we are also enabling for you to test your connections. And if you wanted to edit your passwords, you can do right from here. As you can see, that connection is a valid connection.
Okay.
and you can now browse your Amazon S3 storage. So when I click browse, all I'm doing is that it is opening up all your folders that are there in Amazon S3 account.
Okay.
So I want to move some customer information from S3 to Blob. So I'm going to select this customer information file, and I can look at quick previews of the data as well. So when I click preview data, we're going to go and fetch the first 10 rows. All of these are configurable layouts, so you can full screen them, you can drop them to any resolution you want.
Okay.
So at this point, my Amazon S3 data set is set. I have specified from where I want to move the data and what exactly I want to move. I just named it Amazon S3 DS, and I go back, so my source is configured now. Now I want to move it to Blob, so I'm going to create a Blob connection now.
Okay.
So I select Azure Blob. And now I'm going to say, let's name it Amazon Azure Blob dataset.
Okay.
Again, I have created a Blob connection, so I'm just going to select that, and I'm going to provide the folder where I want that customer information file to be moved.
Okay.
So I'm just going to select data folder and say finish, and at this point, I've specified my Azure Blob dataset as well. Let's rename this pipeline to say S3 to Blob copy pipeline.
Okay.
And one of the other things that we have done with this is that we've made it super simple for you to validate your pipelines before you publish. So you can see over here that we have check marks to tell you actually everything that you needed to be specified is already there. Let's say for some reason you did not specify the source over here. You can actually click validate, and at that point, it will exactly nice. Tell you what is missing.
Okay.
And these are clickable links. So you can click this, and it will take you exactly to the location what is missing.
I can see this being really helpful the larger this becomes, right? Because it will be like a needle in a haystack figuring out what you forgot to configure.
Absolutely. So that is why we made it sure that validation is front and center of this particular experience. And another great thing that we have done is that a lot of times we've heard from customers is that they have production workflows running. And before they do the publish to their production workflow or do any edits to that workflow, they want to do test runs to make sure that whatever new addition or edit that they are doing is working or not.
Got it.
So at this point, I haven't still published this to my Data Factory service, but I can do a test run to just validate that everything actually runs in Azure or not.
But the test run won't actually execute anything. So my Blob storage, so for example, that data folder inside of Blob storage could be empty right now. If I were to run test run, it would still be empty at the end, correct?
No, so it will actually do a test run for you.
Gotcha.
So it will actually do a test run to tell you that the data was actually copied from that Amazon S3 account to this Azure Blob. So once you do that, you are ready to publish, and you can now publish your changes to the Data Factory service.
Okay, so now how do I schedule this to run? I mean, because I probably would want this to run on a basis, like a continuous basis, or on a trigger of some sort. How do I do that?
So once this publishes, then what we can do is that we can actually attach a trigger to this particular pipeline.
Okay.
So we have support for what we call as schedule triggers, and we have support for tumbling window triggers. So let's click this, and you can see that it is actually publishing to the Data Factory service, and it's successfully published
okay.
now. And when I click trigger, I'm presented with this interface where I can either select an existing one. So if I had some triggers already there, I could attach an existing trigger to a pipeline,
okay.
or I could create a new one. So you can see that, let's call this as a schedule trigger. And I want to schedule it every minute, every hour, every day, every week, every month. And we have options within this as well. So if you want to do weekly and you want to do on a particular day of the week at a particular time on that day in the week, you could do that as well.
Perfect. Yeah, this is starting to get me thinking. I have an app that actually downloads the last lottery numbers, but you do that like every Monday, Wednesday, Friday at a certain time, and I'm like, I think I could use this to go and harvest those CSV files for me. But right, what you did here is that you seemingly copied it from one to the other. Can I do something more sophisticated? Like I have a CSV, now I want to parse it and actually put it inside of a database or something that's a little bit more of a data model that I can use later?
Yes. So if you wanted to take that CSV and move it to Azure, let's say Azure SQL
yeah.
for that reason. So in the sync section, we selected an Azure Blob. So you could have actually created an Azure SQL database connection.
Gotcha.
And pointed to a table, and this CSV would have moved to that particular table as well.
Okay.
And one of the interesting things that we support is that we what we call as mapping, right? Nice. So you can map the columns on the left side to the columns on the right side. Okay. So by default, we're going to do a one-to-one mapping, as you can see over here, that we're going to use Microsoft Research technology to do mapping by name.
Okay.
And if the name don't match, then we do it by location, by position.
Okay.
And you have the option to change it if you want to. If you think that property 10 maps to property 0 on the right-hand side, you can change
that. And I can see it looks like you can decide if you don't even want to exclude it or include it. You have complete control over that as well.
Absolutely.
So what I'm interested in now is that, so I have this CSV file, and when I download it, it's every entry. What happens when I do it for the second time? Do I get duplicate entries, or does it only move the one new entry? Because every night it's going to just update that same CSV file.
So we have support for what we call as parameterization.
Okay.
Right? So imagine that you're moving from an Amazon S3 account, and every day on S3, there's a folder structure that is generated with a date timestamp.
Okay.
So you can actually, in your Amazon S3, when you edit it, you could, if you go to connection, you can parameterize your file path. You can say @ folder dot, and gotcha. You can use date time function. So we have support for expressions, functions, system variables, and you can use that. So every day when it runs, it is going to evaluate that function, go to that particular folder with that date timestamp, take that data and copy to Azure SQL. And there also you can set to add it or to wipe or reload. So it's entirely up to you.
Gotcha. Okay, that's the part that I was just saying. All right, one other thing that's caught my attention as we've been poking around is there's a code button over there.
Yes.
I love the fact that you allow me to come in here and graphically manipulate and build it, but sometimes I kind of want that as the starting point, and now I want to take complete control. Is that what that button does for me?
Absolutely. So one of the things that we are targeting is that we are targeting both enterprises as well as ISVs.
Okay.
Now, if you think about ISVs, they would start from this interface, but ultimately they want to stamp it out for their different customers.
Got it.
So they can essentially come here, build their first pipeline, click this code, we will throw the entire JSON to them.
I see.
They can take that JSON and they can use it to build their pipelines further.
I see.
So another thing that I want to point out for ISVs is that, like I showed you the basic scenario where we came in, we built the pipelines, and we essentially published directly to the Data Factory service, right? But let's assume, and I'm just going to discard the unnecessary the changes that we did.
Okay.
So that we are back.
We've already published it anyway,
yes.
So we have it saved.
Yes. So we can essentially attach a code repository to this Data Factory.
Okay.
And we have support for VSTS Git, and GitHub is coming in future.
Okay.
So when you say VSTS Git, we automatically go and grab your Git accounts that you have access to. All the projects inside that Git account.
Okay.
And you can essentially create a new repo, or you can create an existing repo.
Yep.
So let's assume that we want to use an existing repo. And at this point, when I click save, all it's going to do is that it's going to attach this repository with my Data Factory. Now from there on, every time I do any edits, I will get source control, collaboration, I'll get versioning with my Data Factory.
Got it. Okay. Perfect. So that code that's being generated in the background is now also going to be versioned for you so you can use it like a normal. Perfect.
Yes. So as I'm showcasing this to you, once this saves, I'm going to actually navigate to my Git account.
Okay.
And you can see that the mode over here changed to VSTS Git.
Okay.
Earlier it was Data Factory.
Okay,
so
got it. Good.
You can,
I didn't remember. Okay.
Yeah. So it's VSTS Git. And when I go to my repo now, if I look at the branches, I have a master branch. And all my JSONs are right here.
Oh my goodness.
So now anytime you add any new pipeline, that JSON will automatically be over here in your Git account.
Okay, and can I modify it from here as well and see the changes reflected in
exactly.
the graphical one? Oh,
yes.
Perfect.
Yes. And the other thing that we are doing over here is that let's say now you have it in Git, and let's say you want to publish it to the Data Factory service, right? You did some changes, you published to the Data Factory service. So what we do over there is we essentially generate a publish branch, which also has the ARM template.
Ah, I see.
So now ISVs, or even enterprises for that matter, can take this template and stamp it out across different environments, whether it's a dev, pre-prod, a or a prod environment.
Right, because you can actually leverage those ARM templates inside of VSTS even further, right?
Exactly.
Using release management and build to actually automate the deployment of that. That's fantastic.
Yes.
Now, I'm a huge fan of VSTS, if anyone knows me, so it's really nice to see that that integration is already built in.
Yes. And the other thing is that once you have triggered these, then you can also monitor these pipelines end-to-end. So we have this monitor tab where if you go, it's a simple list view interface.
Okay.
So you can see over here that our pipelines have been running and the first one succeeds and we have, I wanted to show the failure so you can see that how a failure looks like and we showcase you the errors right there as well in this particular case.
Okay.
So that's one of the difference between V1 and V2. Instead of slices, we have what we call as pipeline runs.
Okay.
And each pipeline run has activity runs inside it.
Got it.
So I have a S3.2 blob, and in this particular case, I had an earlier pipeline which had a Spark activity attached to it as well. So that's the second activity inside that particular pipeline run. You can rerun it or cancel an already existing run that's happening.
Okay.
Entirely up to you. We have layouts over here which can snap to your time zone. So if you wanted to look all these date times that are being displayed here in a particular time zone, you could do that as well. And then we have these quick options to essentially look at what
date
has happened in last 30 days, last week, last 24 hours. And of course, you can do filtering to say, I wanted to look for a particular pipeline. I could do that as well.
Man, this is a huge release. I mean, there's just so much in there. And you have my brain is racing right now. I was like, I want to like, let's finish the show so I can go play with some of this stuff because I have apps that move a lot of data. And I had to write all that code myself. And now I can leverage this service here to go and do all that low-level moving of the data, and then I can focus on adding the value and not the plumbing of getting my data from the lottery system into my SQL Server database. You can now do that. I can schedule it. It's not even something I have to worry about anymore. So
yes.
This is really a neat feature that I think a lot of us are going to find cool, clever ways of using.
Yeah. And one of the other things that we are making it very simple with this interface is moving data to Azure. Right. So you can see that we have the copy activity, which you can use for a per table or a per file copy. And you can even parameterize it to say that every day run it for a different file in a folder. But let's say if you just want to quickly grab data from a bunch, like you know that I have data in these bunch of tables in SQL or in Azure Blob or in Amazon S3 or in Amazon Redshift or in Oracle, you can actually use what we call as so we have to change the mode, and you can essentially use what we call as a copy data wizard.
Okay.
And all this does is that it just quickly asks you a bunch of questions and select your store, give us your settings, and we will automatically create these pipelines in the backend.
Nice.
You as a user, if you want to be abstracted from these pipeline concepts and just want to provide us a bunch of connections and just want to provide us these are the tables that I want to move, so think of it as the data import functionality that you have in SQL Server, right?
Got it, okay.
So this is that, what we are integrating.
But we can schedule it and we can
Absolutely.
Actually run it as a pipeline.
Yes.
Fantastic.
Yes.
This is very exciting stuff.
And then what we are making sure with this release is that we are providing you guided tours.
Okay.
So if you click these guided tours, it will tell you exactly what you can do on each screen. So these guided tours is actually affinitized to every screen, so it would change based on screen to screen and will tell you what you can do on that particular screen. And
I saw documentation under there too. Does that take us to docs.microsoft.com?
Yes.
Perfect.
So once you click this, it actually takes you to the Azure documentation.
Mm-hmm.
And we have quick links on the overview page. Once you come down, we have links for pricing, documentation, the status. If you want to give us any feedback, want to raise a question, all the updates that we will do, we will list them over here. So all of that would be over here as well.
Fantastic.
Plus, we are open for your feedback as well. So anytime
awesome. You
want to give us a smiley or a frown, you can send it to us. This is by no means replacing the CSS channel
sure.
of raising support requests. But let's say you want to raise a feature request and you want the product team to know immediately, we very closely track this and we are going to essentially keep a close eye on this and make sure that our customers are happy.
Fantastic. We're learning all about Data Factory V2 here on Azure Friday.